Shalom. Let's just open our prayer. Heavenly Father, we just pray, Lord, that you will guide my lips. And Lord, we just pray that you will just help us to understand better how much you love the chosen people. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this conference is 10 reasons why Christians support Israel. I've been given the topic, I support Israel because God loves them. We read about that love in Jeremiah 31, 3 and 4. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore with loving kindness have I drawn thee. Again I will build thee, and thou shalt be built, O virgin of Israel. Thou shalt again be adorned with thy tabrets, and thou shalt go forth in the dances of them that make merry. And then sort of to clarify what God means when he says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, he explains that more in Jeremiah 31, 35 to 37. And Chris made mention of that. We're going to read that again. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, I'll make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah. And skipping down to 35, thus says the Lord, which giveth the sun for a light by day, and the ordinance of the moon and the stars for a light by night, which divideth the sea when the waves roar thereof. The Lord of hosts is his name. If those ordinances depart from before me, says the Lord, then the seed of Israel also shall cease from being a nation before me forever. Thus says the Lord, if heaven above can be measured, and the foundation of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done. So there's two things that God says. If you want to destroy the children of Israel, all you have to do is destroy the sun, the moon, and the planets, and the children of Israel will cease to be a nation. The laws of physics tell us it's impossible to destroy the sun. So that tells me that the children of Israel, sun and moon are still shining. They're still God's chosen people. But I want to share a little bit more about the second part where God says, if you can measure the universe. Well, let's start out with the number of stars. According to the Atlas of the Universe, there are 30 trillion billion stars in the universe. That's in the known universe. 30 trillion billion. The European Space Agency says that there are over 100,000 million stars in the Milky Way. That's the galaxy we belong to. And millions upon millions of galaxies. Someone has estimated that if God were to divide all the stars equally above all the humans alive today, you and I would have 44.8 trillion stars. We don't know how big the universe is. That's of the known universe. Another measurement we can use is just how wide, how big is the universe. MIT says it would take 90 billion light years traveling from one side of the universe to another. 90 billion years, light years. And then they go on to say that they estimate that the universe is at least 250 times the size of the known universe. So to repeat with Jeremiah 31, 37, thus says the Lord, if heaven above can be measured and the foundation of the earth be searched out or searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel for all that they have done, says the Lord. So we can't measure the universe. We can't count the number of stars. That tells you God's everlasting love for Israel continues. I have some people who do not like Israel, and they will argue, well, they may be the chosen people, but they certainly don't deserve to be God's chosen people. They're a bunch of dirty, rotten sinners and don't deserve the blessings of God. And actually, they're absolutely right. God says the same thing in Deuteronomy 9, 4 to 6. Speak not thou in thine heart after that the Lord thy God has cast them out from before thee, saying, For my righteousness the Lord brought me in to possess this land. But for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord doth drive them out from before thee. Not for thy righteousness or for the uprightness of thy heart dost thou go to possess their land, but for the wickedness of these nations, the Lord thy God doth drive them out from before thee, that he may perform his word, which the Lord swore unto the fathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Understand, therefore, that the Lord thy God giveth thee not this good land to possess it for thy righteousness, for thou art a stiff-necked people. Well, why did God choose them if they are a stiff-necked people? We find that answer in Deuteronomy 7, 7 and 8. The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor chose you because you were more in number than any people, for you were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, and because he would keep the oath which he had sworn unto your fathers, that the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondmen from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. So Deuteronomy says God didn't choose them because they were righteous. They're stiff-necked and rebellious. God chose them because he loved them. And to demonstrate how much God loves this rebellious and stiff-necked people, we go to the book of Hosea. Hosea is a marvelous story of God's love for the Jewish people. We're not, of course, going to be able to go through every verse in Hosea, but we're going to give some of the highlights. In Hosea chapter 1, verse 2, we have God's call to Hosea. The beginning of the word of the Lord by Hosea. And the Lord said to Hosea, go, take unto thee a wife of whoredoms and children of whoredom, for the land hath committed great whoredom, departing from the Lord. Imagine, if you're in full-time ministry today, and you sense that God is telling you, go marry a prostitute. Do you think your support is going to go up? Or do you think it's going to drop? Hosea was a prophet of God. And God says, go marry a prostitute. I mean, just think of what that does to the ministry. He's the laughing stock of all the prophets. And then we go in verse 3, Hosea 1, 3. So he went and took Gomer, the daughter of Diblaim, which conceived and bare him a son. So the first child of Gomer is Hosea's. Hosea and Gomer have a son. But the second and third children are not Hosea's. It says in Hosea 2, 4, and I will not have mercy upon her children, for they be the children of whoredoms. And what God is demonstrating here is the ugliness of sin. You know, in Hosea chapter 2, 2 and 3, we have what I think is one of the cruelest commands in the entire scripture. Hosea gives this command to Gomer's illegitimate children. Plead with your mother, plead, for she is not my wife, neither am I her husband. Let her therefore put away her whoredoms out of her sight, and her adulteries from beneath between her breasts, lest I strip her naked and set her as in the day that she was born, and make her as a wilderness, and set her like a dry land, and slay her with thirst. And as Gomer continues her sinful lifestyle, things get worse and worse for Gomer. Sin becomes uglier and uglier. In Hosea 2, 8 and 9, we find out that as sin begins to take its toll on Gomer, she's no longer able to have very many men buying her services. And so in Hosea 2, 8 and 9, we read, "For she did not know I gave her corn and wine and oil and multiplied her silver and gold, which she prepared for Baal. Therefore I will return and will take away my corn in the time thereof and my wine in the seasons thereof, and will recover my wool and my flax given to cover her nakedness." So what Hosea was doing behind the scenes, he was providing the supplies for his wayward wife. And she didn't even know it was he who was buying the food, providing the clothing, because her lovers are no longer coming around. And so things are getting uglier and uglier. And then we get to Hosea chapter 3, and we see God's amazing love for Israel. In fact, there's a video called Amazing Love, which is the story of Gomer and Hosea. You might want to rent that sometime. Fantastic story. Because a central part of that story is Gomer gets so ugly that no one wants her services anymore, and she's sold into a slave market. You know, sin turns ugly. I used to go park at the east side of City Hall in Calgary, and it was the most destitute area in Calgary. This was a hang-up of old prostitutes. The only men who would ask for their service was the real scums of the earth. I had a chance to talk with some of them, and break your heart, the story that they had. And I'm not trying to be funny, or I'm not trying to be cruel, but those ladies were ugly. The years of sin made them ugly. And sometimes I think I was maybe talking to a 40 or 50-year-old lady who looked like she was 70 or 80. Well, this is what happened with Gomer. She's actually taken to a slave market and is about to be sold in the slave market. And Hosea, her lawful husband, goes to the slave market and buys her back. This is Hosea chapter 3, 1 and 2. He buys her back for 15 pieces of silver and a omer and a half of barley. You know, the 15 pieces of silver, I think, is significant because in the Old Testament, if you were a slave and you were killed by a neighbor's oxen, the owner of the oxen was required to pay you 30 pieces of silver. So in other words, Hosea now is worth less than a dead slave. And then when it said an omer and a half of barley, that was grain that was fed to animals. And so she sold for 15 pieces of silver, which is half a price of a dead slave, and an omer and a half of animal feed. She's become worthless. Yet Hosea went into that slave market and he bought back his wife. He redeemed his wife. And this is an object lesson on how much God loves the Jewish people. A few years ago, I became a real good friend with a rabbi. Rabbi and his wife could not have any children, so they decided to adopt a child. And what happened was social services gave the child to them with the understanding that the mother, the natural mother, had a certain amount of time when she could go and demand to have the child back. What happened is after the rabbi and his wife bonded with his child, the mother came and demanded the child to be given back. And the rabbi was devastated, heartbroken. And he wanted to know why God would allow something like that to happen. Well, I was able to share with him something that happened in our own personal life. Ellen and I, we were looking after very young children. Basically, when they were born and to be put up for adoption, there was a period of time when we would look after them until the new parents were able to adopt them. And we had one child, I called him Timothy Ephraim. And we bonded. He was supposed to be gone after a couple of weeks, but the weeks turns into months. And social services actually came to us and said, "No, he's bonded with you. We don't know what happened to the mother. So the mother does not show up. Would you be willing to adopt him?" And so we said yes. And just a few days before the time was up, the mother came and said she wanted her child back. We knew that Timothy Ephraim was going to go to a much worse environment than what he was with Eleanor and myself. And I remember the morning that the authorities were coming to pick him up, and I read Timothy Ephraim these words when he was sitting in my knee. "When Israel was a child and I loved him and called my son out of Egypt, as they called them, so they went from them. They sacrificed unto Balaam and burnt incense to graving images. I taught Ephraim also to go, taking him by his arms, but he knew not that I healed him." And then I went down to verse 8. "How shall I give thee up, Ephraim? How shall I deliver thee, Israel?" And of course, the answer is, how can you give up a child that you've bonded with? You can't. So I was able to share with that rabbi that God has given you some insights into just how much he loves the chosen people. Your love or your pain in losing your child is reflected in the pain that you have experienced with losing the child you're hoping to adopt. Well, let me tell you a little secret. The Jewish people, as bad as they are, do not have a monopoly on sin and rebellion. Some of my best friends are sinful and rebellious Gentiles that would make all of the sin and rebellion of the children of Israel go to shame. They're much worse. And that story of Hosea and the love for Israel has an application for Gentiles and Jewish people living in today's world. You see, like Hosea or like Gomer, we're undeserving of God's mercy and grace. And what is interesting, in Matthew 26:15, Jesus was sold for 30 pieces of silver, the price of a dead slave. And he did that to buy his wife back from the slave market of sin. We were not deserving of that love. We were not deserving of that mercy. He did that because he loved us, just as he loves the chosen people, the Jewish people. But for the Gentiles, let me close with reading from Romans 5, 6 to 9, which is God's love shown to the Gentiles and to the Jewish people living in this age. For when we were yet without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man one will die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commanded his love towards us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath to come. I support Israel because God loves them. He loves them with an everlasting love. I can't count the number of stars. I can't measure the heavens. They're still his chosen people. And to demonstrate how much he loved his people who were rebellious against him, he told his prophet Hosea, "Go marry a prostitute." And when her sin made her ugly and undesirable, God told Hosea, "Go to the slave market and buy back your bride, buy back your wife for 15 pieces of silver and an omer and a half of barley, animal food." And that is a wonderful picture, not only of how much God loves Israel, but Hosea is a picture of our Messiah, who came into the slave market of sin and purchased his wife, his bride, the church. This is Larry Mitchell. Shalom. Have a great evening. Thank you for viewing with us, and hopefully this will give you some insights into just how much God loves the Jewish people.